So tonight, Revelation chapter 1. I trust that God by His grace will help us to understand and see things tonight that maybe we've never seen before. Okay, it starts off with, and this is where most people miss the book of Revelation. You know, they think it's a revelation of the Antichrist, the false prophet, the beast, and the mark, and it's not. Chapter 1, verse 1 says the following. This is the revelation of Jesus Christ. Full stop, look this way. If you read this last book, this is what you need to get on the pages. You need to find Jesus there. If you try your best to explain all the other stuff except seeing Jesus, you've missed the book of Revelation. So, I mean, what do we want to know? Jesus came and revealed the Father. The Holy Spirit is here to reveal Jesus Christ. So what the church needs more today than any other day is a revelation. Revelation of Jesus Christ. Now maybe a great thing, if you read through the epistles of Paul, what we see often is Paul and Peter talks about things that will be our portion at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And many of the stuff in the epistles we don't find because we put that word revelation in, we will get it at the second coming of Christ. And we have mistaken the words for a revelation. A revelation, it means Christ is revealed. So Christ must be revealed. And as soon as I get a revelation of Jesus Christ, I wish we can just go to that, but maybe next Sunday or so. If you go through the epistles and the letters that Peter wrote, that Paul wrote, you can see how many things will become the church's portion if they get a revelation of Jesus Christ. So what is the best way to get a revelation of Jesus Christ? Read the revelation of Jesus Christ. I mean, this is what it says, the revelation of Jesus Christ. It means if I read the revelation, I will see Jesus Christ. And if I then see Him, I will understand the epistles better when I read the revelation of Jesus Christ. That's not difficult to understand. I mean, you got to have an EQ of about minus 70 not to understand what I say today. This is the revelation of Jesus Christ. Jesus has got so many names, but how can you define Him? At one place he's called the Son of Righteousness, spelled S-O-N. And at another place he's called a cloud of glory. At one place he's called a lamb. At another place he's called a lion. The two can't be the same, but Jesus is called a lamb and a lion. One place he's called a servant. And another place he's called the Lord of all. So we can go on. In Isaiah chapter 9, verse 5 and 6, he goes on to explain, you know, Jesus is unto us, a child is born, a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, okay? He shall be called Wonderful. He shall be called Counselor. He shall be called Mighty God. What I'm trying to say at the outset is there's many names that you can call Jesus to, and everything will show another aspect of Jesus. Like when you take a diamond and hold it in the sun and turn it, there's many different colors that's coming through the way you turn it towards the sun. So Jesus has got a many multifaceted name, and every name just paints another picture of Jesus for those who want to know. But let's get the revelation of Jesus Christ. Thank you. He says, which God gave to him to disclose and make known to his bondservants certain things which shortly and speedily come to pass in their entirety. See, people think it's for long in the distance. Here it says, the entire thing of Revelation will soon come to pass, and that was in the days of John. And he sent and communicated it through his angel to his bondservant John, who has testified to and vouched for all that he saw in his visions. Now, what did John see in the visions? The Word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. He said, John saw the Word of God. So, John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word. This Word was God. in the beginning he was with God. And everything that was made by the word of God. So, who is this word? John 1 verse 14. This word became flesh and dwelt amongst us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten Son. So the only begotten Son became flesh. He is the Word of God. So John saw that Word of God. And he saw the testimony of Jesus Christ. Now in Revelation chapter 19 he says, the spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus Christ. So the spirit of this prophecy is the testimony of Jesus Christ, the testimony of Jesus Christ. So if I don't want to know Jesus Christ, I must not read the prophecy. If I read the prophecy, I will understand Jesus Christ. Because the spirit of this prophecy, the book of Revelation, is a revelation of Jesus Christ. So let's try and ask from there. Go to verse 10. I could have read the rest, but I'll just go on. The rest of that first few verses says, blessed is he who reads this prophecy, and blessed are they who will hear it read. So even if you don't understand, the fact that I'm reading today makes you blessed and me blessed. Verse 10, John says, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a great voice like a calling of a war trumpet. And this voice behind him said, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, so we can add to that list of names. Write promptly what you see. Remember what he saw? He saw the word and he saw the testimony of Jesus Christ. Write it in a book and send it to the seven churches which are in Asia, to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, to Laodicea. Now just look this way quickly. Right through the Old Testament, when God got himself a people out of a people, and he called them Israel, which we call the Jews later on. When God got himself a people, the way he walked with them was with the Ark of the Covenant and a tabernacle which they built. And inside the tabernacle was a most holy place where the Ark of the Covenant was, which the priests carried, and that symbolized and that testified that God was with them. And in that place and on that Ark, God manifested himself in all his presence, all his power, and all his glory. And that Holy of Holies is where the presence of God is. God actually want people to dwell there. That's what Moses wrote in Psalm 91 when he says, he that dwells in that secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. So Jesus came to open that Holy of Holies. So the night he was crucified, the veil was rent in the real temple, or in the physical temple on earth, but the real veil in heaven was rent, which was his body when he was dying on that cross, so that now we can spend our time in the presence of Almighty God 24 hours a day, every day of our lives. So we don't have to spend time in the outer court. I don't have to spend time in the holy place. I can live in the most holy place behind the veil. That's why Jesus died. That's why he shed his blood. That's why he paid the price. Now, John, when he was caught up in the Spirit, he was caught up right into that most holy place. Let's say, here's the most holy place. So John was right inside it, there where the glory was. Otherwise, he wouldn't have seen everything he saw. I mean, if you go read what Moses saw, I mean, the rainbows, the sardis, and the stones, and the precious stones. So John was right inside the holy place where he saw the throne and the lightnings and the 24 elders. Everything was around the throne. So John must have been right in the presence of God. And he heard a voice, not inside, he heard a voice behind him. Come on, this is Revelations that's going to help you to understand the rest of the book. Come on, this is Revelations that's going to help you to understand the rest of the book. Verse 12. Then I turned to see whose was the voice that was speaking to me. And on turning, I saw seven golden lampstands, and in the midst of the lampstands, one like a son of man, clothed with a robe which reached to his feet and with a girdle of gold about his breast. John was inside the Holy of Holies. He heard a voice behind him which said, all those names. I'm Alpha, Omega, First, Last, everything. And he turned around, and when he looked out of the most holy place, there was the seven golden candlesticks, which was the seven churches of Asia. And Jesus was walking in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. Now, I want to just say here right now, the churches were supposed to be inside the Holy of Holies. Jesus already opened the veil. And he said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. If I prepare it, I'm going to come back and take you unto me, that you can also dwell there where I am. So Jesus already gave them the promise. He already died, already prepared the place, came back from the cross, told them the place is prepared, and then he came and poured out the Holy Spirit so that they can live there. So after all those years that John saw it, about 30, 40 years later, they were still not in the Holy of Holies. So John looked and he saw them outside the Holy of Holies. So this was why he had to give them a revelation of Jesus Christ, because they were still meddling around in traditions of men, still struggling with the law, still struggling with all legalistic things about the law of Moses, because they didn't enter into the most holy place. I'll preach it as hard as I can. The church was supposed to be there, because that's why Jesus died. So John said them outside. How do I know they were outside? Just look at a verse in every one of these churches. To him that overcome will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. So this church was not yet there to eat of the tree of life. So they were not in the paradise of God, which is the holy place, which is, you know. Okay. Chapter 2, verse 11. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcomes shall not be hurt by the second death. So if I enter there, I will live and live eternally. Verse 17. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcome will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and the stone a new name written, which no man knows, saying he that receiveth it. Okay, verse 28. And I will give him the morning star. Okay, chapter 3, verse 5. He that overcome, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Verse 12, him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go out no more. Okay? Verse 21, to him that overcome will I grant to sit with me on my throne, as even I overcome and sit with my Father on his throne. Now the scriptures I just read are all inside the Holy of Holies, are all inside the most holy place. So John said, I've got a revelation of Jesus Christ that I've got to give to the churches, and they can't find it as long as they meddle around in the outer court. They've got to be inside the most holy place. So John says, I was caught up in the Spirit right into this place, right into the most holy place, and I saw the throne, and I saw the lightnings, and I saw the rainbows, and I saw the worship, but behind me was a voice. And I turned around, and he was walking, the Son of Man, Jesus Christ, was walking in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks, trying to say to them, you've got to get a revelation of me so that you don't have to walk outside there where you can be hurt, where you can be damaged, because if you come in here, there shall no evil befall you, angels will be around you, length of days will be your portion, nothing will touch you, nothing will make you sick, you will live an overcoming life. Okay? So let's see if this is true what I say. So after the churches, here comes chapter 4. After this I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard addressing me like a war trumpet said, come up here, and I will show you what must take place, or which must happen, or which things will come hereafter. When John was, let's just say it, in the most holy place, caught up in the glory, the church was outside. Okay, and then he gave him all the things. If the church would overcome, they would also go there. So he says, and immediately after I saw this vision, the next thing I saw was an open door in heaven. And then that voice that first spoke to me and said, I'm Alpha and Omega, that voice then showed me the church, and then talking about the church, because he's now walking amidst the seven golden candlesticks, that voice said, John, come up here. through the open door into the Holy of Holies. This is where you're supposed to be. Not outside, but inside. I saw an open door. So, and then I will show you things that must happen hereafter, and we will go to that a little bit later on. So, just two scriptures now. Isaiah 64 verse 1. Oh, that you would rent or open the heavens, that you would come down, that the mountains may quake and flow down at your presence. As when fire kindles the brushwood and the fire and causes the water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, that the nations may tremble at your presence. When you did terrible things which we did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. For from of old no one has heard, nor perceived by the ear, nor has the eye seen a God besides you, who works and shows himself active on behalf of him who earnestly waits for him. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. But as it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man, the things which God has prepared for them that love him. But God has revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things are. So there is something that the Spirit wants to reveal to us, what the eye hath not seen, and the ear hath not heard, and has never come up in the heart of man. And it is written. So I've got to find out where it's written. It's written in Isaiah 64. So Isaiah 64 says, when I will understand what eye hath not seen and ear hath not heard, it is when the heavens will be open. Okay? So open the heavens and reveal things to us that we've never seen, heard, or received with our hearts, our ears, or our eyes. Okay? Is that ready? So chapter 2, verse 6 of 1 Corinthians. He says, how about we speak wisdom among all them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew. For had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, I have not seen nor ear heard of him. So let's see if we can put it together. Let's see if we can put it together. He says, there are mysteries that we need to know. Okay? He says, this mysteries will be revealed, that eyes and ears and hearts has never heard or seen or understood. This mysteries revealed is a wisdom that the world will not understand. He says, so it is written, God has revealed it unto us by his Spirit. So going back, he says, it's open the heaven. That is what Isaiah says in chapter 64. But 1 Corinthians 2, talking about open heaven, says, if the rulers and the princes of this world, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. So the crucifixion of Jesus is the opening of the heaven that reveals the mysteries of God that the world will not understand. Let's try, just jump to verse 18 of chapter 1. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Hear the words. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God, it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. For the Jews require a sign, the Greeks seek after wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified. Unto the Jews a stumbling block, the Greeks foolishness, but unto them which are called both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. Now, with that in mind, back to Revelation chapter 1 and Isaiah 29. Verse 10 says, For the Lord has poured out upon you the spirit of deep sleep, and hath closed your eyes, the prophets and your rulers, the seers, he hath covered. And the vision of all is become unto you as the words of a book that is sealed, which men deliver to one that is learned, saying, Read this, I pray thee. And he says, I cannot, for it is sealed. And the book is delivered to him that is not learned, saying, Read this, I pray thee. And he says, I am not learned. Wherefore the Lord says, For as much as this people draw near with me to me with their mouth, that is Matthew 15, with their lips do they honor me, but they have removed their heart from me, and their fear toward me is taught by the precept of men. Therefore, behold, I will proceed to do a marvelous work among this people, even a marvelous work and a wonder. For the wisdom of their wise men shall perish, and the understanding of their prudent men shall be hid. And verse 18, And that day the deaf hear the words of the book, and the eyes of the blind shall see out of obscurity and out of darkness. I hope there's somebody that understands that what Isaiah calls here, the book is sealed so that the wisdom cannot understand. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 1, again, it's the crucifixion. So Isaiah 29, he says, the book is sealed, and they can't understand. Why? Because they stick to the law, chapter 28, precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little. But in 1 Corinthians 1, Paul calls that sealed book the crucifixion. That will then make the eyes to see, the ears to hear, and the hearts to receive. Okay, back to Revelation chapter 4. John chapter 10 first. Verse 7 will do. So Jesus said again, I assure you, most solemnly I tell you, I myself am the door for the sheep. All others who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to and obey them. I am the door. Anyone who enters in through me will be saved. He will come in and he will go out freely and will find pasture. The thief comes only in order to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and enjoy life and have it in abundance. Now, just look this way. It seems like if you find the door, you'll have life and abundance of life. If you don't go through the door, you'll live with thieves and robbers. Steal, kill, and destroy. I mean, I don't think I'm out of context if I say the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I have come to become a door so that you can enter in through me, and when you enter in through me, you will have life and life more abundantly. But if you don't go through the door, you will be robbed, stealed, killed, and destroyed off. But you can find the way. I am the door. Okay, let's jump to verse 17. For this reason the Father loves me, because I laid down my own life to take it back again. You've got to listen to this. This is very important to understand what we're going to read today. No one takes it away from me. On the contrary, I lay it down voluntarily. I put it for myself. I am authorized and have power to lay down my life. I'm authorized and have power to take my life back again. These are the instructions which I have received of my Father. Man, in a minute we're going to read Revelation. It's going to shock so many people. So, when it comes to the crucifixion, Jesus says, I lay down my life. No one can take it. I lay it down. No man can take my life. He says, And in this situation of laying down my life, I want to tell you what I will be: the door. The context of John 10 is the good shepherd. For those who have not heard me talk about that, the history of the shepherds in the east was like that. When nighttime fell, the shepherd had to build a fold with sticks and branches, and then the sheep would be gathered inside that fold, and then the shepherd would go and lay down there as the door. So if anybody wanted to get the sheep, they had to go over the shepherd. So the only way to get the sheep is to kill the shepherd. So Matthew 26, quoted from Zechariah chapter 13, says, "Slay the shepherd so that the sheep will be scattered." Quoting again in Isaiah 53, he says, "All ye like sheep have gone astray, but now you have come back to the fold." Okay, so the night Jesus was crucified, the sheep were scattered. They were running away and hiding because they were scared to be killed with him. But after Jesus came out of the tomb, he started gathering them again. So the shepherd became the door. If the door, the shepherd was killed, the sheep could be scattered. So prophecy after prophecy says the sheep will be scattered when the shepherd will become the door. So Jesus, "I am the good shepherd which will lay down my life." I'm going to lay it down. No one can take it. I'm just going to give it. And in that night, I will become the door. Are you ready? So the open heaven, says Isaiah, quoting it by Paul in 1 Corinthians 2, is the crucified Christ. The sealed book is the crucified Christ. So there's mysteries that needs to be revealed that's not yet been revealed because people don't understand it's a revelation of Jesus Christ. So back to chapter 4 of Revelation. "After this I look and behold a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard addressing me like a trumpet called, said, come up here, and I will show you what will take place hereafter." After what? After the door is opened. So what is the opening of the door? The crucifixion of Jesus Christ. So you've got to go through the crucified Christ to enter into the glory of God and live in the most holy place. How do I know that? Hebrews 10 verse 19 and 20 says, "We can come boldly to the most holy place, so on a new and living way, through the blood of Jesus, through the veil, which is His flesh." So the Word became flesh. So, oh God. So the Word, which became flesh, was crucified to open the door. So the Word became flesh, was crucified, that is, opened the door. Okay. Now I'll show you what will happen here after. After what? After the door is open. "Immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven. And one sat on the throne." So what happened when Jesus was crucified? The Bible says in Philippians 2 verse 5 through 11, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who he was equal to God. He thought it not robbery to be equal to God, but he humbled himself and became obedient as a servant unto death, even the death of the cross. Therefore..." Take it back to Revelation. "Hereafter, therefore, God has highly exalted him." Ephesians 1 and 20 and 22, Philippians, "and set him on his own right hand on the throne in the heavens, given him a name which is above every other name." So, after the crucifixion, exaltation. So, come, I'll show you. You know, if I go through the open door, I will see the throne. So, right through the Bible, in Acts chapter 2 verse 22 to 32, Mark 16 verse 19 and 20, Luke 22 verse 66, 67, 68, it talks about Jesus being exalted to and by the right hand of God. So when he says, "I will show you what will happen through the open door," you will find a throne. He says, and to be on this throne, you've got to understand it's the right hand of God that took Jesus out of the tomb, put him on his right hand, to and by. So that right hand is also Jesus. I'm just trying to put something down. Jesus is Sun, Cloud, Lamb, Lion, Servant, Lord, Wonderful Counselor, Alpha, Omega, Beginning, End, First, Last, River of Life, Fountain of Living Water, the Light of the World. Jesus is now also the door. The shepherd is the door. But Jesus is also the right hand of God. Okay? We are talking about the revelation of Jesus Christ. So I'm throwing in a lot of stuff to read a chapter to you today. Chapter 5. I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with 7 seals. Now you've got to listen. You've got to listen. Now I'm going to talk stuff that's not been written, not been preached, not been taught. If a book is written inside and on the backside, it means the book is closed. If it's inside and backside, it means it's closed. So this is, which is the back and which is the front side of the book if there's no name on it. Okay? So it's written, the book is written all over. So I saw in the right hand of him who sat upon the throne a book. The book is written within and without. Let's keep it there. I don't have to say anything. But I just want to say, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and this Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. Written within and on the backside, sealed with 7 seals. I can just quote maybe 1 or 2 scriptures, because I don't want to lose somebody here. But Isaiah 59 says, God was looking for an intercessor because truth was not anymore on the earth. So he says, and when he could find none, his own arm helped him. And then he explains his own arm. He says, his right hand. Now he explains the right hand. He says, the right hand came and was clothed with righteousness. The right hand came, and for this purpose the Son of God was made manifest to destroy the works of the enemy. He says, so here comes the right hand of God, and when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord is going to raise up a standard against him. What is the standard that the Spirit of God raised up? The right hand of God. So the standard that God has placed against the floodgates of the enemy that is trying to come against the people of God is the right hand of God. So the Spirit of God is raising up a standard which is the right hand of God, which is clothed with the armor of God. Okay? Are you ready? Here's Moses in front of the Red Sea. Egyptians behind him. God says, I will fight for you. Moses laid his rod on the water. Waters open. Israel went through. Waters closed. When the Egyptians came in and they were drowned, Moses wrote a song. He says, your right hand, O God. Your right hand came in, and your right hand destroyed the enemies in front of us. Your right hand opened the waters, and your right hand closed the waters. So if the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord is going to raise up a standard. He didn't say the Spirit of the Lord is coming against him. It says the Spirit raise up the standard. How does he raise up the standard? He allowed the right hand to come in. What is the right hand of God? Nothing else than Jesus Christ himself. So Jesus Christ came to destroy the works of the enemy. Where did he destroy the works of the enemy? When he was crucified on the cross. Colossians 2 verses 12, 13, 14, 15, and 16. He says the letter of accusation that stood against us, he took it away by nailing it to the cross after he spoiled principalities and powers in the cross. So it's in the cross that the right hand raised up the standard. So what is the standard? The cross. So where do we conquer? The cross. How do we overcome? By the cross. So it's all around Christ and him crucified. So Paul says the wisdom is the crucified Christ. If you don't understand Christ crucified, how will you understand the revelation of Jesus Christ? John 6 and 27 says the following. When Jesus talked about him being the bread of life that came down from heaven, also talked about that hidden manna that we just read in Revelation. And he said, him hath God sealed. So Jesus Christ is sealed of God. He's called the door, he's called the Word, and John said, I saw the Word. Where's the Word? Written in a book. Within, hand on the back. It's all. Okay, let's start chapter 5 verse 1. I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof? Come, if you ran with me, he says, this wisdom is hidden from the world. Are you ready? Let's try and read it. And no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. Jesus says, I am the good shepherd, but I am also the door. When I lay down my life for the sheep, I will become the door. No one can take my life. I lay it down myself, and I take it up myself. So I saw the word of God in a vision, and I saw the testimony of Jesus, which is the same vision. So he says, I saw the right hand, in the right hand a book. The book is sealed. No man could open the book, not in heaven, nor on earth, nor under the earth. And I wept much, and this is the all-encompassing one, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seals thereof. Now he explains exactly how he did it. And I behold, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts, and in the midst of the elder, stood a lamb as it has been slain. I want to tell you, read the book of Revelation and see Jesus Christ. So he says, I saw the right hand, which is Jesus Christ, in the right hand a book, written within and without. But the book was sealed, him hath God sealed. So he says, no one in heaven, on earth, or under the earth was found worthy to open the book. For no one can take my life. I will lay it down myself. So the mystery of Christ will only be revealed in the opening of the door in heaven. But this book sealed will broke forth in the crucifixion. So the seals will be broken, the book will be open, that will open the door, that will make you go and see the revelation of Jesus Christ. Verse 1, chapter 1, the revelation of Jesus Christ. What happened with the opening of the book? What did he see? A slain lamb. And he came, verse 7, and took the book out of the right hand of him that sat upon the throne. And when he had taken the book, the four beasts, what was he taking? His life. The word became flesh, dwelt amongst us. How did he open the door? With his flesh on the cross. So the right hand came to help, to raise up a standard against the workings of the devil, to destroy the works of the evil one. So the right hand said, give me the word life. Put it in flesh. Let's go destroy the works of the enemy. Put me on the cross. So let's open the book, break the seals, so that people can get the revelation of Jesus Christ. Now after today, you've got to be very stupid to be able to understand something else when I'm finished. When he had taken the book, the four beasts and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sung a new song. Thou art worthy to take the book. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God, everything that was made by Him. No one can take my life, I'm going to lay it down myself. No one. And they sang, you are worthy to take the book, to open the seals, for I've got this commandment of my Father. I am tonight becoming the bread. The bread, the book. The to open the seals, for thou wast slain, and has redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, and has made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. And I beheld and heard a voice of many angels round about the throne and the beast and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000, 1,000 times 10,000, saying with a loud voice, Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. So here comes Jesus out of the tomb after being crucified. He says to the disciples, Matthew 28:9, all authority and all power has now been given unto me. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to now receive the glory and the honor and the power, because he gave his life. That is, he broke the seal and opened the book. Now that the book is open, he shed his life, laid down his life. Now because of the opening of the book, the door is open. I can now go to heaven and I can live a throne life. So John goes, tell the seven churches, what are they doing outside? Come up here, go through the door, go get the book, get the word on the inside of you, because the Lamb was slain. Worthy is the Lamb. Is there anybody that struggled to see that every word is the same person? The right hand, the book, the scroll, the Lamb, the Lion. It's a oh God in heaven now. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ. Verse 13, and every creature which is in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and such are in the sea and all that are in them, heard I saying, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sits upon the throne and unto the Lamb forever. That is Philippians 2:5-11. Every knee of things on earth, on the earth and under the earth, must bow and confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. When did it happen? When he was crucified, raised from the dead, and he says, rites which must be fulfilled quickly, which was and is to come quickly. And the four beasts said, Amen. The 24 elders fell down and worshipped him that liveth forever and ever. Revelation 1. Verse 19, I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. I have the keys of hell and of death. So far. That's it. I just rushed. I feel that's where I need to close. I just dropped a few things there. So, you has an ear to hear? Let him hear what the Spirit has to say. So I just want to tell you, Jesus paid the price, shed his blood, gave his life. So the thief comes to steal, kill and destroy. I've come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. So the seals have been broken, the book has been opened, the door stands wide open. You can live in the presence of God, life more abundantly. And the 24 elders and the living creatures all say Amen unto him that sits upon the throne and unto the Lamb. So worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive glory and honor and blessing.